Welcome back to the Million Dollar Problems, where we journey into the frontiers of mathematics and the seven Millennium Prize problems. So far, we've explored the elegant mysteries of prime numbers, the structures of elliptic curves, and the unpredictable chaos of turbulence. Today, we turn to a problem that stands at the intersection of logic, computation, and security. This is the question that has kept computer scientists and mathematicians busy for decades.
Of all the Millennium problems, this one is my favorite. It's called P equals NP, and it's the holy grail of computer science, a question so fundamental that cracking it could upend everything from cryptography to artificial intelligence. This will shake the bedrock of our digital lives.
It's intriguing how famous this problem has become. It's not every day that a math puzzle becomes the stuff of movies, TV shows, and mainstream conversation. The movie Traveling Salesman had the problem as its core plot, and then TV shows The Simpsons and Elementary have made it part of their plots.
It's no surprise, this is the most famous of Clay Institute's seven puzzles. Let's get into what exactly is P equals NP. So let's break down what P equals NP means. In mathematics and computer science, P is the set of problems that computers can solve efficiently. For example, finding the shortest path on a map or sorting a list of numbers. These are problems where the solution time scales reasonably with the size of the input. Now, NP is a broader class. It includes all the problems whose solutions can be verified efficiently. Say, if I hand you a key, you can quickly check whether it unlocks the door. But figuring out how to make the key in the first place, that's much harder. At least, we don't know how to do it quickly.
So P is about solving and NP is about verifying?
Yes, and so here's the big question. Are these two classes the same? Is finding a solution just as easy as verifying one? If they are, it would mean P equals NP, and thousands of problems in class NP would become solvable in a reasonable amount of time.
And if they're not the same?
Or if P does not equal NP, it means there are problems that are inherently hard to solve, even though their solutions are easy to verify. And that would reinforce a fundamental limit on what computers can achieve.
Could you elaborate what we mean by solving versus verifying problems?
Of course. Solving a problem efficiently means finding a solution in polynomial time, where the time taken grows at a manageable rate as the input size increases. For example, in sorting a list, while doubling the list size might make the task harder, the growth is far more reasonable compared to problems where the time grows exponentially with the input size. Verifying is about checking a given solution, something computers can often do much faster. Imagine checking if a Sudoku solution is correct. It's straightforward and quick. But solving the puzzle, that can take much longer, especially for larger grids.
So solving is the uphill battle, and verifying is the easy downhill?
Exactly. But here's the catch. If P equals NP, then all the uphill battles we thought were steep might actually have shortcuts we just haven't discovered yet.
You also mentioned that P equals NP ties together thousands of problems. How does that work?
So thousands of problems in computer science, from scheduling flights to predicting protein folding, can be expressed as NP problems. What's fascinating is how they reduce to each other. For example, a problem about packing boxes efficiently can be rephrased as a graph problem, which can then be converted into something like Sudoku. These reductions show that solving one NP-complete problem gives you the tools to solve all of them. It's like having a master key for every lock.
And what does it mean when we say a problem is hard?
When we call a problem hard, we're talking about its computational complexity. Take the traveling salesman problem. The difficulty scales exponentially with the number of cities. With 10 cities, you might have a few million routes to consider. With 20 cities, that jumps to more than 10 quintillion. The time required to solve these problems through brute force becomes astronomical as the input size grows.
Wow. So solving one of these hard problems efficiently would change everything.
Absolutely. Suddenly, optimization problems across industries, logistics, AI, biology, would become manageable. But then cryptography would face an existential crisis because many modern cryptographic algorithms hinge on certain problems being computationally hard. Modern cryptography relies on the assumption that some problems, like factoring large numbers, are hard to solve but easy to verify. If P equals NP, those assumptions collapse. Secure banking, encrypted communication, even blockchain, all would need to be reimagined.
It's a high-stakes game. Where does this problem come from?
Let's step back to 1971. That was the year Stephen Cook published a paper titled The Complexity of Theorem-Proving Procedures. It was a modest title for a groundbreaking work that defined the problem we're talking about today. Cook introduced the concept of NP completeness and showed that certain problems, like Boolean satisfiability, were central to understanding P equals NP. However, the seeds of P equals NP go even further back. In 1956, mathematician Kurt Gödel wrote a letter to John von Neumann. In it, he speculated about whether all mathematical problems that can be verified efficiently could also be solved efficiently. Gödel was hinting at P equals NP long before the terms existed. But it wasn't until Cook's work, and independently Leonid Levin's in the Soviet Union, that the problem took shape. The real breakthrough came 1972 when Richard Karp demonstrated how thousands of computational problems were interconnected. Karp showed that if you could solve one NP-complete problem efficiently, you could solve them all.
Wait, so you're saying solving one solves them all? I guess that what makes this such an important puzzle to crack?
Precisely. That's the power of NP-completeness. These problems are like a web. Cracking just one would send ripples through the entire network. For example, predicting optimal delivery routes for packages, arranging classroom seating to meet all preferences, or designing circuits with minimal energy consumption, all of these fall under the same umbrella of NP-complete problems. And this is not just the number of problems, but the fact that this touches every aspect of our life. Imagine trying to schedule shifts for workers at a hospital while ensuring adequate coverage and employee satisfaction. That's an NP problem. Or consider trying to match students to schools based on their preferences while also balancing available slots. Another NP complete challenge. Optimizing traffic flow across a city's network of intersections, planning the most efficient way to stock shelves in a warehouse, designing the layout for a music festival to maximize attendee experience while avoiding overcrowding, these are all real-world examples of NP problems. Each of these seems distinct, but they're deeply connected in their computational complexity.
This is what makes P equals NP so tantalizing. Has anyone come close to solving it?
Not yet. We've seen progress in understanding its boundaries, but a complete proof remains elusive. And some researchers even speculate that the problem might be independent of our current mathematical frameworks, unsolvable within the systems we have. Let's consider one of the most famous examples of NP-complete problems. This will give us a clearer picture of why these problems are so challenging. This one is one of the most famous examples of NP-complete problems. It's called traveling salesman problem. Imagine you're a traveling salesperson, tasked with visiting several cities and returning to your starting point while covering the shortest possible route. It's a classic scenario that sounds simple, but it's deceptively complex. Let's say there are just three cities. You can calculate the routes manually in a matter of seconds. Add a fourth city, and the number of possible routes grows. By the time you reach 20 cities, the situation becomes almost unmanageable.
Why does it get so unmanageable?
It's because the number of possible routes doesn't grow linearly. It grows by factorial of the number of cities. For three cities, you have six possible routes. For four cities, it jumps to 24. By the time you reach 20 cities, the number of routes is about 2.4 quintillion. Even if a supercomputer could check a billion routes per second, it would still take over 76 years to compute them all.
76 years for just 20 cities?
Exactly. This kind of growth is called exponential growth, and it's the hallmark of NP-complete problems. The more cities you add, the faster the complexity explodes. This is why even powerful computers struggle with these problems. And now imagine if P equals NP. You'd have an algorithm that could compute the shortest route in seconds, no matter how many cities were involved.
It sounds like a game changer.
Would be, but there's a catch. The same breakthroughs that make solving the traveling salesman problem possible could also unravel modern cryptography. Encryption systems rely on the assumption that certain problems, like factoring large numbers, are computationally hard to solve. If P equals NP, those problems become trivial, and our secure communications would no longer be secure.
So it's both a promise and a peril?
Exactly. On one hand, we could revolutionize industries from logistics to drug discovery. On the other, we'd face a digital security crisis. And the traveling salesman problem is just one example. Others include finding the best way to sequence DNA for genetic research or determining the optimal way to lay out microchips for maximum efficiency. These are problems where solving one could mean solving them all. And that's the beauty and mystery of P equals NP. It's not just about computation. It's about understanding the nature of problem solving itself. Until we find the answer, we'll keep relying on approximations and ingenious workarounds.
So what are researchers doing to get closer to solving this?
We are trying to tackle it from multiple angles. A key approach involves proof complexity. This examines whether logical proofs can be shortened and whether certain mathematical techniques can simplify NP-complete problems. While this has led to insights about what makes some problems inherently difficult, it hasn't yet solved the core question. Brute force has its limits because of the exponential growth we discussed earlier. Instead, researchers are exploring heuristic algorithms. These don't guarantee the perfect solution, but often find good approximations in a reasonable amount of time. We already see how delivery companies like FedEx and UPS use similar techniques to optimize routes. Beyond logistics, approximation algorithms also help in optimizing tasks like planning schedules in hospitals, as we discussed earlier, or even designing circuits with minimal energy consumption.
Is there any cutting-edge technology that can bring us closer to the answer?
Well, quantum computing is a promising frontier. While it hasn't cracked NP-complete problems yet, but quantum algorithms, like Grover's and Shor's, can offer exponential or quadratic speedups for certain tasks. These advances might not solve whether P equals NP, but they've already begun reshaping fields like cryptography and simulation.
So it's not a silver bullet?
Not yet. But it reinforces a theme we've seen throughout this series. Every exploration, even if incomplete, pushes the boundaries of what's possible and introduces new tools for tackling complexity. For smaller or specific cases, exact algorithms like branch and bound or dynamic programming are still highly effective. These methods exploit constraints to reduce the possibilities we need to check. Then, complexity theorists are constantly innovating. One intriguing area is geometric complexity theory, which attempts to tie computational complexity to the deep structures of algebraic geometry and representation theory. This is a highly abstract approach, but it offers the potential to reframe P equals NP in entirely new ways. Another promising avenue involves connections to physics. Some researchers explore whether the laws of computation could be linked to physical principles like energy minimization or entropy. Finally, machine learning models are being used to identify patterns in computational problems, potentially offering new insights into their structure. While they don't directly solve P equals NP, they can provide data-driven shortcuts to better heuristics or even identify mathematical properties we hadn't considered before.
It seems like the tools developed for this problem are helping elsewhere too. I think that is also a general theme we saw across the series.
Oh yeah, true. One of the most exciting outcomes of the P equals NP journey is the techniques developed have impacted other fields. For instance, the study of proof complexity has improved automated theorem proving, enabling tools that assist mathematicians in exploring vast problem spaces. Similarly, approximation techniques born out of necessity for NP-complete problems are now core components of AI systems, from recommendation algorithms to route planning. Even attempts to design better algorithms for NP-complete problems have led to breakthroughs in optimization. impacting industries like logistics and manufacturing.
Let's imagine for a moment that someone solves P equals NP. What happens then?
We've already discussed some of the potential impacts, like revolutionizing optimization and AI. To build on that, imagine AI systems capable of generating optimal algorithms for thousands of tasks, from designing energy-efficient buildings to creating personalized medical treatments. It's the logical extension of what we already see with today's heuristic algorithms, but on a much grander scale. If P does not equal NP, it means there's a hard limit on what computers can achieve efficiently. This reinforces what we discussed earlier about exponential growth in problems like the traveling salesman or DNA sequencing. It would validate that some problems are inherently hard, no matter how advanced our tools become. But even that knowledge guides research. Just like the approximations and heuristics,
what do most researchers suspect? Do they lean toward P equals NP or other way around?
The majority of researchers believe P does not equal NP. This belief stems from decades of effort where no efficient algorithm has been found for any NP-complete problem. It's also intuitive. Finding solutions often feels inherently harder than verifying them. Think about Sudoku. Solving a puzzle requires trial and error, but verifying a solution is instantaneous.
Is it just intuition, though, or is there stronger evidence?
No, there's more. Many researchers point to barrier results, which show that certain proof techniques, like relativization and natural proofs, are insufficient to resolve P equals NP. These barriers suggest that solving the problem might require entirely new mathematical tools. Additionally, experiments with thousands of NP-complete problems consistently show their exponential nature in practice.
But some must still hope for P equals NP, right?
Of course, if P equals NP, it would mean that problems we thought were impossible to solve efficiently actually have hidden shortcuts. It's an appealing idea. Who wouldn't want to unlock the full potential of computation? That's why researchers keep an open mind and continue exploring both possibilities. Whether or not we solve it or not, the journey itself is transformative. As we discussed earlier, it's not just about finding an answer. It's about deepening our understanding of computation, logic, and the limits of human ingenuity.
And perhaps the greatest lesson of all is that some questions are as valuable for the pursuit they inspire as for the answers they yield. It ties back to everything we've covered in this series, the beauty of the unknown and the drive to explore. So with that, let's close another chapter of The Million Dollar Problems. Join us next time for the season finale, where we discussed the one and only one of the Clay Institute's original Millennium Prize problems that have actually been solved, the Poincaré conjecture.